No one, I think, receives more intense reaction from an audience and brings emotions to such a high pitch as Judy Garland when she performs. She is one of a kind, and she opens tomorrow night at the Garden State Arts Center in Holmdel, New Jersey. And I suggest if you want to see somebody who walks out and takes an audience in the palm of their hand from the moment she walks on stage, it is this young lady, Miss Judy Garland. I didn't get that kind of reaction when I was born. Yeah. Yes, I did remember my dad did go, yaha, yaha.
I imagine the doctor did.
Yes, right in the mouth he got me. He held me the wrong way.
Aww.
Hey, I thank you for coming tonight. You know, you've never done this show before.
I know.
And because usually when you're in New York, you're busy and you've got a concert date or something.
Yes.
And I thank you for coming here tonight.
You're welcome.
And you look wonderful.
Thank you.
That is why.
Thank you.
What do you think of this outfit?
Well, I think it's beige.
Yeah?
Yes, it's awfully good.
Is it too wild, you think?
No, I think it's kind of underplayed.
For a crook, you mean it's underplayed. But
no,
you know,
it's very charming, it really is.
Well, men, you see, always wear dark suits, and you gals can wear things like this, and they're the mini skirts or the lace, and guys always have the same old jazz, and I figured just for the fun of it.
Why did you wear a beaded Nehru suit or a jacket?
A beaded Nehru? I've worn the Nehru, but beads and I just don't.
No.
I don't get along. Beads don't make it for me.
Why?
People always stop me on the street.
I imagine so.
Yes. Hey, where's Holmdel? I talked about Avalon tonight. They're going to be mad already about Avalon. Doc said he didn't like Palisades in New Jersey, but where's Holmdel? New Jersey, the Garden Arts Center.
It's near,
It's on exit 117?
Garden State Parkway.
Well, you heard where it is.
You're a great ventriloquist. Sounded like that came right out of the audience. Gee, that's why I didn't know you did that, too.
Yeah.
It's on the gardens, off the Garden State Parkway. It's off the gardens. That's my little Orphan Annie impersonation. It's off the Garden State, off the Garden State Parkway on exit 17, right?
117.
117.
Yes.
Should never fool with your fans.
No.
They'll come down and lynch me.
Oh.
It's a hostile group, isn't it?
I love them.
Do you play in the, They do. Is this in the round, or regular theater?
Yes, it's the biggest round I've ever seen. It's quite magnificent. It's a half indoors, because it's a shell.
Oh, with a covered bandstand,
you know,
type of
and,
thing.
It's quite stunning.
Do you like that kind of, does it give you closer intimacy with the audience? Working like that?
Well, with about 10,000 people in the audience, it's a bit hard to give an intimate show. But
you do. I've seen you work when you've had a huge group, and you get that intimacy from the people. Does that mean we're leaving for a second? All righty, I thought maybe it was a lesson. We're coming right back. Oh, no. We'll be right back. She's a dream, you know it?
Yes, she is.
And talent. She's got all your talent. Easy to see where the talent came from. And then her husband, Peter and Chris, are great. They're back in Australia
now.
She's not
married to both of them.
No, I meant she's married to Peter.
Yes.
And they're back in Australia now?
Yes.
Hey, let me ask you a couple of questions here, because we didn't really plan anything, and we'll just throw questions. Anything you don't want to answer, why, you know, say, what's been the high spot in your life? You've had so many great moments in front of audiences. What has been one standout thing that really...
Well, one of the many comebacks. Must have been, let me see. I think working at the Palladium Theatre in London for the first time was my best thrill.
And that was probably
and then
a command
the palace
performance.
After that.
That's got to be. Because when you came in at the Palace here, it was absolute bedlam.
Yes, well, I like bedlam.
You thrive on bedlam, don't you? Huh? What is it that gets your audiences, and I'm not trying to put you in an awkward position saying that, because you have such a rapport with the people who love you and come to see you. I mean, it's really adulation, and it's unique. You're unique with it. Very few performers have that. But you create that wonderful empathy, I guess is the word, with an audience. And I've seen you work many times, and it always happens.
I haven't a clue.
You try to analyze it at all?
Well,
it's really probably an unfair question because it's putting you on the spot.
I think it's because I adore them, you see, and then...
It comes across.
Yes, and I... Well, it sounds silly.
No, it doesn't sound silly.
But I do think it's awfully nice for people to come in and sit in uncomfortable chairs and pay money to hear me sing. So I like each person in the audience, and it seems sort of a marriage.
It has to be, because I know performers are... I think you're right. I don't think performers, you've seen performers who've, I'm sure, come out on stage and kind of throw it away,
as
we say in the business. They don't feel in the mood or something, so they kind of toss it. And
I
the audience resents
it.
The audience resents it highly.
Yes.
I think you should give what you can give.
I think it's rude.
Yeah.
Yes. After all, if you're going to be on stage, you know, don't look down at the audience with disdain.
You enjoy it, don't you? I mean,
I adore
that your biggest personal satisfaction, being in front of an audience?
Well,
I guess it is
yes.
For most performers.
I don't want to be there all the time.
Of course not.
You know, but because I like to be with my children sometimes. Most of the time, as a matter of fact. But I do like being in front of audiences, naturally, wouldn't you?
I love it. I don't think
well, you are.
We would do this crazy business. When I leave, I'm going into the aluminum siding business. Very closely allied to show business. I've always had that back on my mind. Has there anything you've ever wanted to do that you've never done?
Retire.
Oh, come on now. Come on now. You don't really want to, do you? I mean, quit singing?
Well, I'd like to be terribly rich. I mean, sort of disgustingly rich. And so
there's nothing wrong with that.
No, not at all. And then just be able to sing when I want to. And then if that were the case, I'm sure I'd be singing every night.
That always happens,
yes,
doesn't it?
Yes. I don't know if it always happens.
No, people always say if they get enough money, they would retire, but they don't.
Really?
Joey Lewis put it pretty well once. He says, I've been rich and I've been poor, and believe me, rich is better. I think there's
a little
truth there.
You bet your life. Remember that game you were going to...
Yes, yes, I think I do. Who's had the greatest influence on your career? Your entire life?
On my career?
Yeah.
MGM? No.
No, I would imagine so.
And vaudeville before that. Vaudeville was kind of...
You worked with your sisters originally in vaudeville.
Yes, and my mother.
I love vaudeville, and I always love good acts. No, I do, I mean it. I like acts per se. Acts that come out and
work
with
You wouldn't have liked our act.
Was it a bad act?
Terrible. Really a bad act. Terrible.
What did you do? What did you do in the act?
Well, we just sang, you know. Diner, always. And I got to sing a solo. My mother would choose my songs, which was something inevitably like Trees, when I was 4 years old.
I think that I
remember
that one.
You know, or Buddy, Can You Spare a Dime? It was Once in Khaki Boots, gee, we look swell, full of that. Yeah, well, that looks dumb. With a little girl 4 years old.
No, but that was a hard, that was a grabber, wasn't it?
Yeah, but I wasn't a soldier. But at any rate, we did have we weren't in very good vaudeville. You know, no Keith time or Orpheum time.
None of that stuff, huh?
No, we were.
What are some of the acts you worked with?
Well, we worked with some pretty strange acts. There was one man who had a Western quality about him, and he'd come out on stage. He had a singing coyote with him,
I beg your pardon? A singing coyote.
Yes.
I like him already.
Yes.
I don't know why.
But poor soul. Coyote was his only means of living.
Yes.
So he would drag this thin, mongrelish thing and start to play the banjo, and he would sing a bit, and the coyote would go, oh. Well, the Humane Society heard about him, and they...
Much less the Musicians Union.
Now, the Humane Society decided that that the only reason the coyote howled was because the guy's music hurt the coyote's ears. So they took the coyote away from him, and he went into the business of being a fire eater, which is rather switch, I think.
Well, most good coyote acts can double as most of the singing coyote acts I've known, if they've fallen on hard times, have gone right into fire eating. It seems to work out. I don't know.
No, this was disastrous because it takes about 6 months, I guess, to learn to do all that, you know, much exotic music. This is right from Western banjo. And he had flowing robes and all this business, and when he finally got to the part where you really sort of, you know,
put
swallow
this.
That first torch, we were standing in the wings waiting to follow him, and unfortunately, this was his first time after going to fire eating school for 6 months.
Oh, oh, oh.
They do have.
I'd love to see the graduation on that. That must be a great ceremony.
But anyway.
So this is the first appearance.
Yes, first appearance. And he had just come out, and he'd only been on stage about, 2 minutes, and people were quite impressed. And he suddenly. He forgot to put that sick gelatin in your mouth. That keeps you from being absolutely burned to death. And as he did this, he just went, ah!
And the coyote ran in the back door. Thought he was...
No, he threw the torch and caught the curtains of the theater on fire and burned the whole fire, the whole theater down.
You had some great acts.
Yes,
what was the best? What's the best act you worked with?
Did
you ever work with... I always heard about Fink's Mules. That was one of the names of the big vaudeville acts.
Yes, they wouldn't let us on the same
bill. Fink's Mules were
category. No, we weren't that good. We worked with the man who just threw up for his living. We did. It sounds awful.
That's a bad act. That's.
No.
I ask you for a bad act. That's a bad act.
No.
Is there a lot of call for that? I mean. I mean,
no.
The auditions must have been terrible. Class bill.
No.
That was a class bill. The guy with the coyote and this fella.
Yes. And no, he would come out with this. He was a great big, fat, ugly fellow, and his name was Haji Ali, and he had all sorts of chic outfits, you know,
yes.
Turban and so forth. And he'd just stand and not do anything. He didn't dance, he didn't talk, he didn't do anything. Then his wife would sort of come out with, you know, with the balloon pants, chiffon and so forth, with an enormous fishbowl on her head, full of a fluid which was half kerosene and half water. And she'd hand the fishbowl to her husband, and then he didn't dare talk, I guess, for fear from the last show something might occur.
Are you putting me on?
No, I'm really not. No,
all right.
No. And she would say, my husband will now drink this fishbowl full of liquid, which is half kerosene and half water, and I'll go over here to this sort of oriental outdoor barbecue, and he will, I'll light the fire, and he will then bring up the bar, and first he'll The kerosene will come, and then the water will put the fire out. It's true.
I remember them, the aristocrats. Wasn't that the act?
Oh, yes.
That is the wildest act I've ever heard of in my life.
Oh, well, he was marvelous because do you know how long it takes to drink?
No, no. Not to mention putting out the fire. No, not the slightest idea.
Just, you know, for 8 minutes going, and finally he finished this, and one drum roll. We only had 3 pieces in the band in those days, and he would then turn and sort of do this, and the bloody outdoor barbecue was way over there, and he'd simply and out would come the kerosene first, and the audience would get
then
a bit nervous.
Then it was on fire, and then the fire.
And then the water came.
How did Sullivan ever miss that act? Huh?
You know why?
If Ed would ever seen that act, he'd have gone crazy.
The man died of ptomaine poison.
Yeah. I'll buy
cafeteria.
That.
Cafeteria. You know, isn't that strange?
Got hold of some bad food and went, huh?
Yeah. Got it.
Oh, that's wild. That's funny. Yes. Let me do this.
It's... Why don't you advertise some cafeteria?
Oh, yeah, yes. It's Louis Nye, I presume, showing you how to save money during the 2-for-the-money sale at Rexall. We're going down memory lane with some of the bigs in showbiz. What are some of the... Have you got any? I know you can't have another act than that in vaudeville. Who's the favorite person outside of vaudeville that you've ever worked with, whether it's in motion pictures or anything?
Mickey Rooney.
Mickey?
Yeah.
You and Mickey were sensational. There is another great chunk of talent.
I should say. Oh, he's brilliant.
And no, I really think that people... If Mickey, because of his size, he was limited in certain parts he could play. But he's got great, great... natural acting ability, and if Mickey would have been, and I'm not saying this patronizingly, and properly handled, boy, what a career. And he's had a magnificent career.
Yes, he has. I don't think his size would have meant that much.
Oh, I'm only saying, like, leading man or something, or the young leading man was difficult,
I suppose.
Well, I
could have gotten short leading ladies, I suppose.
Yeah, I suppose so.
He was your favorite. Munchkin,
he was, who's your favorite gal to work with?
My favorite one?
Gal to work with.
Well, I liked all the women I worked with. I didn't have any fights with any of them at all.
Those days of going to the studio school must have been fascinating, because all of you, with Mickey, and who were some of the other youngsters
the
at that time? Yes. That was quite a class, if I remember.
It was quite a strange group. It was Freddie Bartholomew and Mickey Rooney.
Freddie Bartholomew, I believe, is now an advertising executive with one of the agencies in New York City.
Yes, that's right. But he was then, you know, Little Lord Fauntleroy in the Dickens thing, absolutely beautiful English child, and then Mickey Rooney and Lana Turner and myself, and some strange girl, little tiny thing, called Juanita Quigley.
Juanita Quigley?
She Juanita never made it somehow.
Juanita Quigley.
And we had Deanna Durbin.
Deanna Durbin.
Yes. Dina Durbin was there. And that was about it.
Did you ever learn anything in those classes, or were you...
Not a thing.
What was it like? Just nuttiness all the time?
Well, we always had...
Tell you what the rules were, I think, that you had to be tutored so many hours a day.
Yes, according but to... they would be broken up, you see. You could do 10 minutes of history, say, and then you'd have to go rushing to the set because they were ready for your scene, and you'd do that and then go back and try to do the history. And I wound up reciting more history in the scenes and doing, I got it all mixed up. I must say, I can cop out. Anyway, I just think I was plain old ignorant.
You ever see Mickey anymore or run into any
people? Yes, yes.
I think Mickey, the last time he was with us, was doing a picture at the time. I think he was also had a school for youngsters.
Yes.
Talented youngsters, yes.
An acting school.
They don't do that anymore, do they? The major studios where they put a lot of youngsters under contract now.
No, I don't think they do. I think they should. It's a good training ground, you know. It's rough, but it's good.
I'll bet it is. How long will you be down at Holmdale now? I understand Five days down?
Five nights.
5 nights, starting tomorrow night, which is June the 25th. Which will take you right up through Friday night, right?
That's right.
I hope, well, I know you'll kill them down there. You do every place you perform. And so it's on Garden State Parkway, Route 117 at the Theater Arts Center, is it? Or? Thank you, sir. The Garden State Arts Center down there. And I can't thank you enough for coming tonight.
Well, I can't
really.
Thank you.
Really, you're a doll. She gets in front of an audience. She's dynamite, isn't she?
Does she have fans?
She's quite a gal. Yeah. She has said quite a life. We'll be back in a moment. Bennett Surf with us. Here's a word from the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company.